Yeah, absolutely. You really are amazing. And, you know, we know that God has you in this place for a reason today. And we are so grateful for dads who say, hey, instead of wanting to go play golf or watch golf on TV, say, hey, you know what, I'm going to go to church. I'm going to take my family to church and I'm going to honor the Lord. Thank you for doing that, dads. And that means a whole lot. And that tells me what kind of man you are. And we really, really appreciate that. We just want you to know we honor you for that. And I think that fathering is the toughest job that there is. I don't think there's anything harder. I think there's a lot of things you can learn. And for men, you know, speaking from a man's perspective, because I am one, and I'm 100% sure about that.
100%
right?
True.
All righty. And I just want you to know that, you know, sometimes what happens during times like this, we just kind of hear about how bad we do and how we're not doing everything and how we're not fulfilling. And yes, the statistics weigh it out. We know that today in the society that we live, we know that almost 50% of homes, there is not a biological father in the home. And that has gone up from 9% in the 1940s all the way now to almost 50%. And in some communities, that statistic is 71%. 71% of kids do not grow up with a father in the house. And Hopkins University has done a study over the last 30 years. And this reality. This is not focused on the family. This is not from a Christian perspective. And they put the number one reason for the society in which we live, the number one reason for insecure kids, the number one reason for kids committing suicide is the fact that there is not a father within proximity. And dads, I want you to know your role is crucial. And moms, that does not diminish your role whatsoever. How many of you understand that we're okay with honoring when honor is due? We're okay with, you know, we're not going to try to be always, I'm not even going to try to be politically correct. I'm as politically incorrect as they come. So I just want you to know when we elevate someone, when we honor someone, that's not to devalue someone else. So we absolutely do not devalue the role that moms play. And thank God for moms that are there, that are taking on roles that they should not, because the fathers are absent. And that statistic is mind-boggling, but the only thing it only measures the physical absence of dads. It does not even measure the emotional absence of dads within the home. And so we know that there's a lot of negatives, but I want you to know that this is not one of those days where we're going to say, okay, after service, let's flog the dads. You know what I'm saying? Let's nail them. Because dads, the fact that you are here tells me a whole lot about you. And you might not have done everything right. You might not have been perfect. And there's only one perfect father. And even he had rebellious kids. And so you and I have to recognize and understand that God has got something amazing. So today, the reason I wanted to say this now, because today's just going to be different. Today, hey, they told me, I asked them, well, what's the service? Because I was out in Houston and in San Antonio. We just flew in on Saturday morning. And, you know, I asked them because they had the meeting, well, how's the service going to go? And so I asked Erica before service, I said, so is it okay if I do this? And she told me, she said, Pastor Annie, you do whatever you want. So I have permission from Erica to do whatever I want today. So here's what I want us to do. I want us today to just to come with a different heart, come with a different understanding, an understanding that God is our Father. And there's so much to that. It's so powerful through Scripture. And if you would allow me just to do things a little bit differently today, let me do it a little differently just to be impressed by the Holy Spirit. And, you know, it's amazing that when you read the Old Testament, there are only 15 references to God as Father in the Old Testament. You have to wonder why there are only 15 references to God as Father, and five of them is in reference to the children of Israel, God being the Father to the children of Israel. But there's only 15. It probably has to do with a lot of the fertility gods and fertility goddesses that were in that time. And so God the Father did not want them to be confused. But something amazingly happened when Jesus comes on the scene. When Jesus comes on the scene, this is profound. He talks more about the Father than anything else. As a matter of fact, in the Synoptic Gospels alone, Jesus refers to the Father, the Synoptic and the book of John. Jesus refers to the Father over 165 times. Over 165 times in four books. Think about that. And he refers to the Father in a way that we can understand, the Father of lights, the Father. Why? Because, and he uses a word that was not, throughout the Old Testament, this word was never, and even in Jewish culture, this word was never used for Father. He uses the word Abba. Now, several years ago when we started studying this and understanding this as a church collectively, we thought that the only ones who used Abba was little children. But that's not true. Abba is being used not only by little children, but also those who are older towards their fathers. And the reason the word Abba, it is so powerful because it is a connection, and it's not just daddy, but it's father. It is an all-encompassing. And when we talk about the fatherhood of God, you have to understand, you've got to remove all the sexism from it, because God has no sex. How many of you understand that? There's neither male nor female. That's why the Bible, there's a lot of references to the way that God is a mother. He's El Shaddai, the breasted one. He nourishes us and feeds us. So there is references to God having the characteristics of the mother. Jesus overlooking Jerusalem, he's saying this: "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I long to gather you under my wings like a hen gathers her chicks." So we understand that this is not a sexist reference, but the reason why we have to understand, why we've got to grasp the whole concept of fathering and who our father is, because from our father we get our identity. And because we have an identity crisis, it's because we've lost the fact that he is our father. He's our father that we can go to. He's a father that we can trust. He's a father that we can rely on. So when we come together collectively in worship, we bring our hearts together as we are going to sing this next couple of songs. We're going to come with an attitude of worshiping our Father. An attitude of understanding that maybe you grew up in a home. Maybe the word Father today for you has a negative connotation. Maybe for you that word Father is difficult for you. Maybe it's hard for you. When I say Father, you say, Annie, you don't realize that my father was absent. You don't realize my father was abusive. You don't realize my father was a freak. You don't realize who my father was. And some of you are carrying some of that. But I believe today in worship, you and I can come to the place of our Heavenly Father and understand that He is a good, good Father. And not only is a good Father, He is a kind Father. He is compassionate, and He wants to engage you on where you're at today. He wants to engage you in that place of your pain. He wants to engage you in that place of your difficulty. He wants to engage you right now in this very moment. But what He needs from you, He needs you to open up your heart. He needs you to come in an attitude of reverence and an attitude of worship. He needs you to come with a knowledge that He is a God that is more than enough. He wants you to come with the knowledge that He is able. He is able to remove all the stuff, all the junk, all the guilt, all the shame, all the bad stuff that is hanging on to you like a bad hitchhiker. He wants to remove that from your life and bring you into full grace. That grace that I can receive, that grace that I'm fully loved, that grace that I'm fully accepted, that grace that I am His no matter what. I belong to Him. So when we come to that place of fatherhood, when we come to that place of coming before our Father, Jesus taught us to pray. The reason Jesus used Father so much, because it was not just a way to address God, it was the way to address God. You have to get that. It is not a way, it is the way. And collectively together, there's only one reference in the New Testament about our Father, and it is when Jesus teaches us collectively to pray, our Father who art in heaven, or our Father, we are hallowed, we are made holy by your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Oh my goodness, everything you need, everything you ever wanted, everything you ever longed for, everything that your heart has ever cried for, everything on the inside of you that's crying out for fulfillment and longing, and the emotional needs that you have and the physical needs that you have. Can I tell you something today? As your pastor, I want you to know that I'm sorry that you're hurt. I'm sorry that you're in pain. I'm sorry that you struggle. But I want you to know you can bring all of that in this moment. You don't need somebody to lay hands on you. You don't need somebody to prophesy over you. You might need somebody to slap you. For that, I'm available. But what you need your father. You need your daddy. Every single one of us need our dad. And you need your heavenly father to come right now and put his arms around you and whisper in your ear. Maybe you've never heard this from a natural father. But you can hear this from your Heavenly Father. I'm proud of you. I love you. I have a purpose for you. You are mine. When the whole world says, I don't know who you belong to, I don't know whose child you are, you know, I'm a son of God. I'm a daughter of the Most High King. That's who I am. That's my identity. And today I put my trust in Him. I put my faith in Him. I want you to bow your heads just for a moment. Father, we thank you that we can come in a moment like this, a moment of surrender, a moment of holiness, a moment of peace, a moment of purity, a moment when the Holy Spirit comes in our lives and you invade the Rock Church in a way that we're so used to ritual. We're so used to two songs and a poem and a prayer and a preaching and running out. But today, we just want to spend a moment. We just want to say, here we are, Father. Here we are with all of our brokenness. Here we are with all of our messes. Here we are with all of our pain. Here we are with all this junk that we've carried around with us, all the blaming, all the finger pointing, all the what they've done to me and how they've done it to me. And yes, we know it's justifiable. But your word says, unless we die, we cannot live. Unless we lay it down, we cannot pick up true life. And if we want to find ourselves, we need to lose ourselves in you. So in this moment, we want to lose ourselves in you. In this moment, Lord, you know every person in this room. You know them by name. You know their journey. You know their faith. You know their joys. You know their ups. You know their downs. You know everything about them better than I can ever know. But I ask you now, in the same way that Jesus prayed and said, Father, I know that you hear me when I pray, but for their sake. So this morning I pray, I know that you hear me when I pray, but for their sake. May you come now like a flood. May you come now like a warm embrace. May you come now with holy love. May you come now with peace and joy. May you come now with the spirit of freedom. May you come now and break every yoke. May you come now and move in every heart. May you come now and bring freedom to the captives. May you come now and open the prison doors. May you come now and let your people walk to the freedom that you purchased for them on Calvary's cross. May you come now and set every young man free. May you come now and set every young woman free. May you come now and set every old man free. May you come now and set every elderly woman free. May you come now and set every child in the freedom that you purchased for them. Come, Father, and move by your Spirit on every heart. Move by your Spirit in this place and heal every broken piece. While every head is bowed and every eye closed, if you're here today and you say, Hennie, that's me. Oh, I try to put it together. I try to act like it's all okay. But I'm really rattled on the inside. I'm really shaken on the inside. And I need God's loving hand just on me. I need God's loving touch just to embrace me. I need to know that I have value and I'm valuable. If that's you, and you, if you would be brave enough to do something for me, would you just pop your hand up so I can see you? Thank you. 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 I'm going to mess with the service today. So here's what I'm going to ask. And this might be hard for you. This might be tough for you. But would you, that raised your hand, would you do me an enormous, enormous gift? Because I believe this will help you. Would you get out of your seat and would you just walk to the front? Would you do that? Would you do that? Would you just come out of your seat? Would you just come to the front? Just come right here. Just come on up to the altar. It's okay. It's okay. Let's make room. Come on. Let's make room for them. Just let them in. There's healing grace. There's healing grace in this place. I'm going to ask you guys just to play something. And I'm going to ask some of the pastors and leaders if you could come and just... And I'm just going to come down if this is okay with you. I'm going to come and I'm just going to give you a hug. That's all. I'm just going to come and put my hand on you just to let you know that your Father, your Heavenly Father, cares about you.
Believe. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
Let's all stand to our feet.
It's who I am. It's who I am. Who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Be your name. Let your kingdom come in us and through us. Let your will be done by us. Thank you that you gave us this day what we needed more than daily bread. We needed a touch from our Father. We needed to know that our Father loves us. Thank you. Thank you. And now we pray that your work of grace that was started today will be a work that will not be depleted or deleted by the enemy's devices, but that we would be smart enough, that we would be equipped enough, that we'll have a depth of wisdom and understanding to know that you are processing wholeness in our lives. And that you're moving us from grace to grace and glory to glory and faith to faith and victory to victory, so that we may stand on that hill, so that we may declare our God reigns, our God rules. He is my Father. I am His child. That is my identity. And we thank you for that. We worship you and honor you for that. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody who believes that says amen and amen and amen and amen. Let's give him a shout that he's worthy of. Hallelujah.